welcome to Trust TV, a show designed to provide insight into the mind of a professional investor. My name is Simon Elliott, Head of Investment Trust Research at Winterflood Securities. And we're joined today by David Smith, Portfolio Manager of Henderson High Income Trust, to talk about delivering income at a time of uncertainty. But before we hear from David today, here's a little bit of background on the topic we'll be covering.
The COVID-19 pandemic forced fund managers to confront unprecedented challenges, none more so than those seeking to generate income in the face of widespread corporate dividend cutting and suspensions throughout most of 2020. As 2021 unfolds, we are seeing a very different economic landscape unravel, with the worst effects of the coronavirus largely behind us. For UK investors, dividends form a large part of the market's enduring appeal. Indeed, the widespread restoration of payouts has led to a forecast yield for the FTSE 100 of 3.7%, ahead of other major equity markets. In this latest episode of Trust TV, we speak to David Smith, Portfolio Manager of Henderson High Income Trust, to discuss the trust's recent performance, his approach to determining value, the role of bonds within the portfolio, and other themes relevant to the UK income-seeking investor. 5 years since Brexit, could UK equities be returning to favour?
So David, it's been a very strong year for Henderson High Income. I think the share price and NAV have grown by over 40% and 30% respectively over the last 12 months. What have been the key drivers behind that performance?
It's been a very strong period for markets in general. Obviously supported by firstly the news of vaccine development, successful rollout, and the subsequent opening up of economies and the sharp rebound we've seen in economic growth, etc. So in that environment, it's actually been the cyclicality within the trust that's done well. Those cyclical stocks and the likes of industrials, so Bodycote, TI Fluids, those companies. Also financials have done well in that environment. So we own St James's Place, the wealth manager, also M&G, things like that. Higher markets, clearly good for their profitability, and that's been shown, in the subsequent improvement in their share prices as well. But also some of the reopening plays that we have. Those companies that have been most impacted by lockdown, by their profitability. Clearly the opening up economy means those profits can start growing, and you've seen a sharp rebound in some of those share prices. So National Express is one we hold, and that's actually done well over the last 12 months, having had a tough time the previous 12 months, but actually it's quite interesting. Some of those stocks, we still think there's quite material upside to go from here, as and when those profits recover to that sort of 2019 level going forward.
And has gearing been a positive factor in this period?
It has as well. Being an investment trust, we do utilise quite a bit of gearing within the trust. And that's obviously had a positive benefit given the positive market backdrop we've had, really.
Now, income's a really important part of Henderson High Incomes, as the name would suggest, the story. And in the last financial year, which ended in December last year, so 2020, you actually increased the dividend, or the board increased the dividend on the trust. Can you just talk about how that was achieved against a backdrop when obviously we saw a lot of UK companies cutting their dividends?
Yeah, it was a particularly harsh environment for income investors last year. Material dividend cuts, material dividend suspensions, etc. We all know the story. I think in total, the income for the market in aggregate was down about 44% in 2020. Now, in that environment, the trust wasn't immune. But it was certainly much more resilient. And there's a number of factors because of that. I think firstly, one of the unique features of the trust is our ability to own bonds. And then within that bond portfolio, we saw no defaults. So that coupon income kept coming in. So companies were prioritising payments of bondholders over shareholders, and that benefited the trust and that diversification. I think we were also quite defensively positioned. So owning the likes of consumer staples, utilities, healthcare, big overweight sectors within the trust. And those companies not only continued to pay their dividends, they actually grew them in the period as well. So it was a case of being much more resilient. That's not to say we weren't impacted. So versus the market down 44%, our revenues were down on an underlying basis around 17%. But again, it comes back to the unique structure of an investment trust. We had revenue reserves. So over the last 10 years, we've built up revenue reserves to about £10 million worth. So we're actually able to utilise some of those, a modest amount, should I say, to cover that shortfall, to be able to not only pay the dividend, but actually modestly grow it in what was quite a tough year that proved to be in 2020.
And you mentioned the bond portfolio there. Normally, what would you expect the bond portfolio to generate in terms of the kind of income part in any given year?
It all depends on the outlook and how big that portion of the portfolio is. I mean, certainly, we were around about, when we started 2020, we had about, I'd say about 18% of the net assets in bonds. So I think, you know, given where bond yields are, that probably produced around about that sort of 18 to 20% contribution to the income. I mean, where we've gone over the last sort of 12 to 18 months, we've very much lowered that bond portfolio, recognising where bond yields have fallen to, recognising where credit spreads have gone. You know, clearly we're at, you know, historical low levels for that. So actually that 18% position has moved down to more like 12% as we are today. Now, I think bonds still have a place in the portfolio. You know, they diversify the income, you know, as proved the case last year. But also they give you ability to sort of reduce the overall volatility of the trust, especially in significant periods like we saw in 2020 in the early part, where we saw significant drawdowns in the equity market. Having that balance, especially against the gearing within the trust in bonds, helps reduce that overall volatility. So, you know, it's still there, it's still producing income, but it's a lower portion given we think there's better valuation and better income opportunities probably in equities from here.
And we have a question actually from one of our viewers. They've asked, where are you currently seeing opportunities in the UK market, and could you cite one or two stock-specific examples that you've recently added to the portfolio?
Yeah, so I talked earlier about how cyclicals have done well over the last 12 months. Actually, over the summer, they've actually done poorly. I think, you know, worries about Delta variant, worries about peaking economic momentum has put a bit of pressure on the share price. And actually, we're seeing good opportunities within that area of the market, really. And a couple of the names that we've added to, Page Group, which is the recruitment consultant, you know, very well diversified in terms of the verticals it serves, but also well diversified in terms of that geographical exposure as well. And I think it's quite a good business model in terms of it's very capital light, very cash generative, net cash balance sheet as well. So actually now that profitability has recovered, it can now pay quite attractive dividends, both the ordinary, but also supplemented by special dividends as well. And I think it gives you a good hedge as well against sort of wage inflation. So, you know, big talk about pressures on wages, etc. You know, most companies, you know, that's an added cost to their business they need to mitigate elsewhere. But actually for a recruitment consultant, given you're taking a percentage of fees on the level of wages, actually that's a good area of the business where, you know, you will see that, or hopefully see that, you know, increase their margins and their profits really. So we bought into Page Group. Elsewhere in the market, we have added to our banks exposure, so not new in terms of our holdings, but added to Lloyds and NatWest, the two banks that we own. Again, you know, with the regulator removing dividend restrictions, you know, we think they can start paying a good dividend growth coming through into next year, given they've got very strong capital ratios, and given actually they've come through the pandemic quite well in terms of the level of impairments we've seen, really.
And in terms of your investment style, I think value is probably an important element of your decision. I mean, would you say that valuations overall at the moment are still fundamentally attractive?
I think so, certainly in the UK. I mean, if you look at the performance of the UK market relative to Europe, and especially relative to the US, it's lagged really a lot, certainly over the last 5 years and even actually over the last 10 years. And actually, when I look at the valuation of various different sectors, you know, across the market, it actually shows you that the UK is cheap in every single sector relative to Europe versus where they've traded historically. And I think that's typically why you're seeing a lot of M&A activity in the UK market. Mm-hmm. It's not that, you know, a lot of people say the UK market is cheap because it's overexposed to some of those old economy sectors, you know, energy, banks, etc. Well, given the evidence we're seeing across M&A, it's a cross sector. You know, valuations are cheap, financing is cheap. That's the evidence I need that's showing me that actually the UK market is very attractive across the broad range of sectors. And that's the opportunity, I think. Especially because I think my outlook for equities is still positive. Mm-hmm. I think we have seen the first phase of a recovery. We're in a bit of a consolidation phase, a bit of volatility, a bit of concerns about Delta variant, inflation, you know, tapering, where interest rates go, etc. But actually, fundamentally, for me, when you look at the economic growth, both in the UK and globally, it's probably going to be above trend, both for this year and next year. And that's generally a good environment for corporate earnings. And as I said, when the starting valuation is attractive in the UK market. I think that's why you'll get still get good returns, or you could still get good returns in the UK equity market.
And just kind of building on that, can you tell us what your outlook is for UK dividends over the next few years?
Yeah, I mean, certainly we've seen a good start to 2021 in terms of the bounce back in income we've seen. And that's been driven by a number of factors. Firstly, mining shares. You know, the mining companies have changed their dividend policies to be a set payout ratio. So clearly in a very, you know, seen a strong commodity price recovery, that plays nicely into the company's cash flows and they pay that out as dividends. So you've seen strong growth in the ordinaries, but also you've seen that supplemented by large special dividends as well. Clearly the bank's now allowed to pay their dividends again. It's obviously been helpful for the market as well. But also some of those companies that were impacted by the pandemic, you know, have actually come back and paid a dividend sort of earlier than probably we expected and higher than we probably expected. So the retailers, the house builders of this world, etc. Having said all that, you know, we've seen a good bounce back in 21. I think 22, you're still going to see growth in dividends. I guess it's going to be a little bit more muted than the sort of bounce back we saw this year. Number of factors. A, I think mainly because of mining. So with commodities moving higher, that's obviously been good. We've actually started to see commodity prices start to come off, and that means that actually those really strong payments that we saw this year probably unlikely to be repeated next year. Now, I think we're still going to get good dividends, just not the sort of level we saw this year. Now, offsetting that is probably the banks, where we're going to probably see bigger dividend growth. And obviously, there's still an area of the market that probably needs to come back in terms of those dividends. So the likes of travel and leisure, hospitality, etc., where they, you know, they're still pretty much, their business is still pretty much under pressure in terms of cash flow. Actually, I think, you know, later next year, that's probably the time when they start to come back. So that's kind of where I see the picture in terms of yield over the next 12 to 18 months, really.
And just on that note, just on the outlook for earnings, if we think back actually to Henderson High Income, I mean, it has a strong record of growing its dividend for consecutive years. I think it's grown its dividend since 2012. And I think the yield that the fund was offering, certainly at the end of August, was about 5.6%. So in terms of looking forward, if we can, where do you think investors in Henderson High Income should have a degree of expectation in terms of dividends?
Yeah, I think, you know, as I mentioned, you know, we have seen a strong rebound in dividends from the market in this year. You know, but I think, you know, the market level of dividend is still going to be below where we were in 2019. So I think in all reality is the trust is probably likely to have to dip into revenue reserves again this year as we did last year, but certainly to a lesser degree than we did last year. You know, the chairman made the point at the interim statement saying the board are, you know, barring any unforeseen circumstances, keen to at least maintain the current level of dividend utilising those revenue reserves. And actually those revenue reserves were still in a very robust place at the start of the year. They still provided 70% cover on the full year dividend. So I think we're still in a very good place, certainly as the chairman suggested in his statement, to at least maintain the dividend going forward.
David, that's all we've got time for today. So thank you very much for your time.
Pleasure. Thank you very much.
That's all we have time for today. Thank you very much, David Smith, for being our guest. We hope you found some useful insights in today's discussion. If you have any questions, please email the address below and we'll get back to you. And for any further information, visit the website on screen. Goodbye for now.